God tonight. No, anytime I come into the presence of God, no, I don't just want to come and be door and go.
No.
Because the Bible says what? We should travel in our prayers. Mm. So anytime that we come before God, how serious, the seriousness that you show before God, that's how God also acts on you. So tonight we want to hear the word of God. No, this week, it has been a prayer week. It has been a fasting time, no? No, waiting upon the Lord for the convention, having a special encounter with God. Because tomorrow, we know that tomorrow is going to be fireworks.
Yes.
And Sunday is going to be fireworks. Because Jesus has come to what? To die for us.
Amen.
And as our team goes, what? Out of the grave, another life.
Life.
And we believe that, you know, tonight we're going to hear something. I don't want to just speak everything.
No.
Because what is going to come is going to be wow.
Yes.
So when we read Psalms 52, it says what? Awake, awake. And put on what? Your strength. So tonight, I just wanted to put one your strength on. You want to struggle with God tonight. That any death that we are in is going to what? Bring us out and put what? A new life.
Yes.
Don't expect only tomorrow or Sunday. Tonight, God is with us.
Yes.
No, sometimes we put our expectation too high, but the moment that we are with God, we forget that tomorrow we are going to convert. So today, we will not take it serious. But because we have come before His presence, and our God be with us, and the Spirit of God be with us. The Bible says, anytime we come before Him, He has a special what thing for us. And tonight we believe that God has something special with us.
Amen.
So we will not waste time. We want to invite our elder and our elders to come and give you the word of God. And put your hand with the heart and hands up to you.
Amen. Man of God, God bless you.
Amen.
You're on fire.
Yes, I'm on fire.
Amen. He's on tight. So the front seats are reserved for the angels,
yes,
to come and occupy,
yes,
it. I thank God that the angels will occupy it so that they can see me face to face. And by the time I leave here, I get all the angelic favors.
Amen.
Oh, Father, we thank you. We thank you. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Lord, we are grateful to you. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, yes, Lord. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Sister Sandra, come and sit here and give me anointing. Come. But very soon you'll be singing for me. Amen. Come. I've vacated my seat for you. Oh, Father, we thank you. I will not pray again. I'm already on fire. Atmosphere is conducive for the word of God to come. But the Bible says, where two or three are gathered in His name, then He is here. We thank God for His presence. And in fact, today is a Good Friday. Abby?
Yes.
So what is good about today? What is good about today that we say Good Friday? Who can help me answer this question? What is good about today that we say Good Friday?
What is good about it?
Yeah.
Because it's the day the Lord took all our sins to the cross.
Good. Somebody was suffering, was being beaten and spattered on. And early in the morning, somebody has not even brush the teeth, and they spit on you. Even when they spit to you, how do you feel? Chocolate, they spit this early morning, spit on you. This man took it, yet we call it good. Amen.
Amen.
That is by faith. Amen.
Amen.
The theme given unto this convention is out of the grave, another life. Out of the grave, another life. And it's taken from Psalm 30, verse 3. Last time, when I was pondering over this, I said, what has it got to do with Jesus' death? So I begin to pray about it. And it's like, I must find out why this psalmist David wrote this psalm. But if you don't get the background of the Psalm 30, you will not understand anything. Most people say that this psalm was written by David during the time of his dedication of his temple to the Lord. But if that so is, how can temple dedication or palace dedication have to do with our conversion of Jesus' death or in terms like this? So I begin to pray and study about it. That's why God laid upon my heart. The story behind Psalm 30 is that David, once upon a time, he numbered the people of Israel for war. whilst God has not asked him to do anything. God is almighty. He can use only one person to conquer an entire army. So you again, going to number your soldiers and your people for war means you are underestimating the power of God. So therefore, the Bible says, God's anger kindled against David. He didn't seek his face, he just did it. And God said, don't worry, I'm not going to kill you, I'm not going to throw you. I have three options for you. Option number one, you are going to have 7 years of famine, no rain, no water, scarcity of food. Think about it. Second option, they're going to give you 3 months of defeat. The enemies will attack you from left and right. They're going to trash over you for 3 good months. Think about it. The third option was, I'm going to allow pestilence, sickness, diseases to sweep over the land of Israel for 3 days. Think about it. So here was David, a man of prayer, crying and weeping. The Bible says he picked the third option. 3 days of pestilence, sickness, and disease swept over the land of Israel. And out of this, 70,000 people lost their lives. 70,000 people lost their lives. Come to think of it, why should one person sin and innocent people in the land got punished? Let's turn it upside down. Why should we sin and just one innocent man be punished? You see the revelation here? Good. So, in the course of David's affliction, he became very sick. He wept unto the Lord. So the Bible says he built an altar in a place called Arauna. That was the same place years back Abraham sacrificed, was about to sacrifice his son Isaac unto God. Some scholars even believe that that same spot was where Jesus was crucified, but that's why I don't buy it yet. But I know these two facts. So that tells me that if you know where to touch God's heart, he can always be attentive to your cry. So the Bible says he built an altar there and then offered the altar unto God. And during the giving of the altar unto God, he wrote the Psalm 30. So if we read the Psalm getting to the end, he said, you have afflicted me. He was near death. Let's read the Psalm 30 and see what he wrote, that you can catch the story. So you can imagine somebody who has the blood of 70,000 innocent people on his hands. How he will cry, how he will weep, how sleepless he will be. But Psalm 30, I read from the verse 1. A psalm and song at the dedication of the house of David. He said, I will extol thee, O Lord, for you have lifted me up and has not made my enemies rejoice over me. But God said, choose. Either you choose that I will let your enemies come and wipe you off, or, so verse 2, he said, O Lord my God, I cry unto you, and you did what? You healed me because of the sickness. O Lord, thou hast brought me my soul from the grave, and that hath kept me alive, that I should not go down to the pit. So you see the story here. He was so much sick, he was stricken. He was very near to death, but God remembered his covenant with him, and then he took him up. I'm going to verse 8. He said, I cry to thee, O Lord, and unto thee I make my supplication. What profit there is there in my blood when I go down to the pit? Shall the dust praise you? Shall they declare thy truth? Hear, O Lord, I and have mercy upon me. Thou art my helper. Thou turn from me my mourning into dancing, and thou put on my sackcloth and gathered me with gladness. So here he was happy that God saved him. This is a background story behind the Psalm 30. So as you begin to read the Psalm, think about the story. Why one man could sin and innocent people paid for it? And how many multitude of people like you and I sinned, and one person paid for the price? So out of the grave of David, God gave him another life. And out of our grave through Jesus, God has given us another life. So the theme come exactly and fit. I thank God for such a revelation. But how did the people of Israel use this psalm? they always, or the Jews always use this time when they are dedicating temples and synagogues or important buildings unto the Lord. Two, when they declare a fast or a feast, they always sing this song. And lastly, when they are enjoying after being purged of their sins, they always sing this song. So I thank God so much that he gave such a revelation to his people that we should go along with this Easter convention. Hallelujah. But I thank God, today is a Good Friday. We call it good like I asked in the beginning. Because of one thing that God did for us. That's why we are celebrating today. So I want you to turn your Bible with me to Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Let's see something there. Please, if you are there, you can read for me.
Romans chapter 5, verse 12.
Yes.
From the New King James Version. Therefore, just as through one man's sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men, because all sin. Should I continue?
Continue for me.
For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who had not sinned according to the likeness of the transgression of Adam, who is a type of him who was to come. Verse 15, but the free gift is not like the offense. For if by one man's offense many die, how much more than the grace of God and the gift by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abounded to all.
Amen. It's okay. Thank you. God bless you. Which version is it?
New King James.
New King James. Good. We thank God. Some other translations say it another way, but I like what we just read. Romans 5, verse 12. He said, wherefore, where? If I see you walking in the street and I ask you, where are you going? What comes into your mind? I'm asking you about what? A place. Good. So wherefore, by one man's sin, by one man, sin entered the world. Where? Where did it all begin? Where did it all start? Wherefore, one man. Who is that man? So there's a question to be asked here. Where did it all begin? It all began in the book of Genesis. When God had finished making man, putting him in the Garden of Eden, Genesis chapter 2, that's where I'm talking from. The Bible says, he told Adam, or he commanded him, saying, of every tree in this garden, you are free to eat. But of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, you shall surely die. When God speaks, it becomes a law and becomes a creation. So who created death?
Who created death?
Yeah.
God
himself created death. But the death he created had no power. It's like a bottle standing there. That bottle has no power. When does a bottle have power?
When it breaks,
then it can cut you. So that was how it was. So God created death powerless. And said, Adam, listen to this command. Of all these trees, you are free to eat. But the tree of the knowledge of evil and good, don't eat. Because the moment you eat from it, the word there surely means, I, God, will make sure that something we call death, which I have made, but have no power, your sin will give him power and he will kill you. So the choice was up to Adam. So actually speaking, it was not death who killed Adam, but what killed Adam? His choice. Amen?
Amen?
So, lo and behold, in the course of time, Eve came into the scene, the serpent was there, and then he deceived the woman, and he took off the apple, and or what we say, the apple or the fruit, and he ate. The Bible said, when God came into the scene, Adam, what have you done? Have you eaten of the fruit that I told you not to eat from? And that time, everybody started pointing fingers. This one, but that was not the issue. The issue is that I told you and I promised you that the moment that you eat of this, you shall surely die. And that moment that Adam ate the forbidden fruit, the Bible says he died. But when you read further to Genesis chapter 5, the Bible says Adam lived 930 years and had children. So what kind of a death is this? Think of this. Have you thought about this? Everything about God is three-dimensional. Everything about God is three-dimensional. For example, the Bible says, there are how many that bear riches in heaven? Three. The Father, the Word, and the Spirit. Good. Whenever you talk about Jesus Christ, we say, Lord Jesus Christ. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. David first anointing, he killed the bear. The second anointing, he ruled Judah. The third anointing, he ruled over Israel. Amen. Everything about God is three, three, three. Come to think of Joseph. His first coat of colors, his father gave to him. When he went to Egypt, the another coat get from Potiphar. The third coat get from Pharaoh. He ruled the whole land. Amen. So everything about God is three-dimensional. So the death you are talking about is also three-dimensional. That means, number one, the first death that God was talking about is the departure of his Holy Spirit for man. So the moment Adam ate the forbidden fruit, that first dimension took place. God's Spirit left him. Amen. The second dimension is, when he departed from God's presence, you are dead. Because after they sinned, the Bible says God drove them away from the Garden of Eden, God's presence. That's the second dimension. And the third dimension is when your spirit leaves your body, you become lifeless. Comatose, you are dead. That's the third dimension. So many people are walking around today with no seat on, with no Holy Spirit, they are walking dead. Our children that we give birth to, they are dead babies to God. Why? Because God's Spirit is not in them yet. Sunday we dress and come here, we jump up and down and go to home and then do whatever that we want to do. If the Holy Spirit is not in us, you are walking dead, period. That was what happened to Adam. Amen. So, the Bible says in Genesis chapter 5 that Adam gave birth to his own kind. Don't forget, he is dead. Genesis chapter 3. The moment he sinned, God's Spirit left him. He became dead. Yet he lived and had children. So that tells me that dead people can give birth to dead people. They can give them to dead people. So in a matter of time, the whole world was full of dead people. Why? God's Spirit was not in us. Amen. Secondly, they have been driven away from God's presence. That's the second death. They were no more in Eden. God's presence was not there. That is why whenever somebody gets away from God's presence, they begin to do mad things. Look at the gang crimes on the street. Look at those armed robbery. Do you think they come to God's presence, they will go and kill somebody for money? No. Look at what is happening, what happened recently in Brussels. Do you think these men are God-fearing people who are always in God's presence, they will kill other people? No. So that means whenever that you depart from God's presence, the only thing you do is madness. You are dead. You are seconds of death. The last death that you are waiting for is the comatose. That time you call your name, you never hear. Amen. But the Bible says, God did not form this world to be in vain. According to Isaiah 45, verse 18, he made this world to be inhabited by people, but not dead people. So there was a need for God to make his plan. And according to Proverbs chapter 19, verse 20, the Bible says, many are the plans of man's hearts, but only the counsel or only the purpose of God will stand. God's purpose for making this world was that may his children will inhabit this earth against the situation whereby we are walking dead. Therefore, God must come up to something. Amen. Amen. So, the Bible says, in the fullness of time, when God thought that it's time for me to redeem my people, he sent forth his son to come. So, John said, behold, there comes the Lamb of the Lord, of God, who took away the sin of the world. So the sin that you and I are going through today, we didn't do it. You are a sinner by virtue of the fact that you have been born. Period. You have no choice. That's why David, when he was confessing sins in Psalm 51 or 52, he said, in sin did my mother conceived me. In sin did my mother fashioned me. How can that be? Just like my baby Christabel, some few months ago, he can't even talk, and she's a sinner. How can that be? Genealogy, right from the blood of Adam, the rejection, the departure of the Holy Spirit from him has transcended up to today. So if you know somebody, your colleague, your classmate, who has not taken Jesus Christ as his personal savior, he has no Holy Spirit, your friend is a walking friend, a dead friend. Your wife, your spouse, he doesn't believe in the Holy Ghost. He doesn't even have the Holy Spirit. He doesn't even go to God's presence. He's just a walking dead wife or husband to you. So that means you and I will have a task to perform. That sister, brother, you are dead. How do you mean I'm dead? But I'm talking. Yes, dead men talk. Adam was dead, but he talked for 930 years. But this is the most dangerous death that you can ever experience. And like I said earlier, everything about God is three-dimensional. So when Jesus came, he died all these three deaths one by one to make you and I complete. Amen.
Amen.
So today, when we can say that we are in Christ, and today is a, happy Good Friday, then there's a reason for us to be joyful. Many a times when we come to say, let's give thanks to God. Thank God, I thank you that you give me food to eat. You protect me from to go to my work and come back, but I thank you. Finish. Men don't have any tangible reason why we thank God. And when it comes to, let's pray for forgiveness of sin. Oh, that is 3 seconds. But then you know I'm the seed of Abraham. I say from the beginning. That's why you brought your son to come and die for me. Father, thank you. I say, finish. But if you know the price that Jesus paid, if you know how it meant that somebody must die in your place, if you know how you feel that somebody should substitute his life for you, every day you go along thanking him and praising him. Look at the estate in America. That time they had this electric chair stuff. Somebody raped a girl and he died. And that man was supposed to be in an electric chair and he's supposed to be electrocuted and killed. But the Bible says the wages of sin is death. Yeah, the man has sinned, so his wages is finished. The judge didn't spend 1 hour to waste on this man who raped a small child. Bible says, in the Constitution says, if you kill somebody, you should be killed. Simple. Come and think about you and me. This man was put in an electric chair. They put this thing around him. Some few minutes, he was dead. But the question is, can his death raise up that little girl who was there? No. So human formula is meaningless formula. But thanks be to our Lord Jesus Christ, whose formula gave us a new life. You were supposed to be in the grave, but he picked up from the grave and gave us a new life. That's why we say Good Friday. It's good for me and you, because he did not see us to die like how our father Adam did. So God saw that the whole world is full of chaos. Everything was in a right order. He said, God gave it in his heart. He said, is it the man that I made? My spirit has left man. Man can't even please me anymore. Now God kicked Adam and Eve from his presence. The last death that they are waiting for is their comatose. That they will die flesh and their spirit will leave their body. That's what they're waiting for. And in the course of this time, the Bible says, he gave birth to his own kind. So your father is there giving birth to you. The baby boy, you are dead. You grow, dead man grow. You have a wife, another baby. So generation after generation were dead people throughout. So God remembered and said, no. I am God. Whenever that I speak, I am suffering. My purpose will forever stand. Don't forget. Before he made man, the Bible says he took counsel. He said, let us make man. So when I come and say, Deacon Vivian, let us go and buy a car for BRWC. Deacon will bring his idea. Elder will bring his idea. Everybody, we are taking a counsel. But the Bible says in Proverbs that only the counsel of God will stand. God's counsel was that he will make man to fill the air and subdue the earth. But here the situation whereby man has become dead people. how can a dead man rule the earth? So in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son Jesus Christ. That's why the Bible says in John 3:16, this verse, for who is it written? John 3:16. It was written for who? John 3:16. For you? No. The answer is there. Read it. For God so loved the world. God loved the world. You and I, we are lucky. I shouldn't use the word lucky. We are saved by grace. We have come out of that darkness of the world into his marvelous light. So for God so loved the world, so it's you and I to tell them, God loves you. You are working dead, working student with good academic and a PhD and doctorate and whatever, but you are dead. But God so loved you that Jesus Christ came. So please come out of that dead and come to God's presence to have life. Mm. Hallelujah. Mm. But we have become so selfish these days, we can't even proclaim God's goodness to somebody out there. For God so loved the world that he gave it. Are you in the world? Talk to me. Are you in the world? Or you are in Christ? It's two things. Either you are in the world or you are in Christ. Where are we now? Talk back to me. I mean, I want to hear. Are we what?
Christ.
Are we in the world?
No.
Are we in the world?
No.
What are we?
We are in Christ.
For God so loved them. So that quotation is for who?
The world.
So it's you and I to tell them that today is a good Friday. Somebody loves you so much that he put his life for you. That you shall become not a living dead, but a person who will have eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
So, when God thought of redeeming man, he had to come up with a plan, redemption plan. Say redemption plan.
Redemption plan.
So God had to deal with sin. And to deal with sin, he must deal with death. And to deal with death, he must deal with a man that has sinned. Amen. Is God a human being like us? No. God is what? John 4:24 said, time has come that those who worship God must worship in truth and in spirit, because God is what? Spirit. Do spirit have blood? No. Can spirit die? No. Therefore, God must become a man like me. So in the 4th Genesis chapter 3, the Bible said, God said, this same woman that you, Satan, you caused her for mine to fall, this same woman is going to provide for me a womb. I'm coming to enter this woman. This woman is going to give me flesh with blood. And when I come, I'm going to crush your head. And then you're going to bruise my heel. What God said that in the Garden of Eden, that means that God said, there's going to be an enmity between you and the woman's seed. And then he will bruise his heel and he will crush your head. This is a Hebrew idiomatic expression. Now the heel there in your Bible means, those days, there were no medical doctors as we have now. No nurses like Dickness. So when a baby is born, for them to control that the baby has life in him, they will hold the heel. So if the child make a noise, because that is where it's painful. When now we cut every ligament here, you can't even walk. So that heel was a sign of life. Amen? Amen. So that was how they used to check if the baby has life or is still born. Amen. So that is life. So God told Satan, this man or this seed, he's going to crush your head and you will bruise his heel. So you're going to bruise his life. And the head means authority. So the moment you take his heel, he's going to crush your authority. So that promise was made far back as Genesis chapter 3. So Good Friday we see today didn't happen 2,000 years ago. No, back in Genesis. The moment God made that pronouncement, he made the provision for it. So when you go to Isaiah 53, let's go there. Isaiah 53, I like that place. Isaiah 53, King James.
Isaiah 53,
from one down.
Who has believed our reports?
Who has believed our reports?
And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?
Mm.
For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant,
mm-hmm.
and as a root out of the dry ground.
Ah.
He has no form of comeliness.
Mm-hmm.
And when he sees him, there's no beauty
mm.
that we should desire him.
Mm.
verse 3. Mm-hmm. He is despised and rejected by men.
He is despised and rejected by men.
A man of sorrows.
A man of sorrows.
And acquainted with grief.
With grief.
And we hid, and as it were, our faces for him. He was despised.
He was despised.
And we did not esteem him.
We couldn't. You can't even look at him twice. When he says came as, please hold on. He came as a substitute for you. He was so much mutilated that you can't even look at him twice. Why? Because the whole world's sin was upon him. God said, you are going to be my redemption plan. You are going to be the lamb I'm going to sacrifice you to get the people back to myself. So the Bible says Jesus Christ was offered as a lamb who was to be slaughtered. Please continue.
Verse 4.
Surely.
He has borne our grief.
He bore our grief. Hold on. Some people will go to bed and they will be crying. Tears will fall down from you on their pillows. They are so much grief and so hard in their hearts that they are Christians. The Holy Spirit filled, they speak in tongues. The Bible says he bore what? Our griefs. He said he does only come and take away the sin. Because when Adam did that and God said, the man was grievous, he was sad. Because he felt his relationship with God had been broken. But Jesus Christ came and took that grief. Please continue.
He carried our sorrows.
Our sorrows, he took it.
Yet we esteem him. Smitten by God
by
and
God.
Afflicted.
So by who spoke Jesus Christ?
God.
God did it, not you. God did it, not Satan. It's God.
But he was wounded for our transgressions.
He was wounded for what? Our transgressions. The things that Adam did, that one single disobedience. Please continue.
He was bruised for our iniquities.
Our iniquity, he was bruised. Genesis, God said, you will crush his head and he will bruise you. Continue. The chastisement of our peace
was upon him.
The world leaders can never give us peace. This democracy can never give us peace. Human ideologies and methodologies can never give us peace. But the Bible says our peace, the chastisement of everything was upon him. So if you are going through tribulations and tough times, and you are happy because of one day we call Good Friday, this is one of the reasons. Please continue for me.
And by his stripes we are healed.
By his, before they kill, you know why you want to kill this man? Why don't you go and kill him? But rather they chain him to a pole and beat his back so much that his tongue begin, his flesh begin to tear apart. And even there he said, by those stripes, rheumatism was well. Diabetes was taken away. High blood pressure was taken away. Arthritis was taken away. Every sickness that you can name off. As far as I'm concerned, there are 39 major sickness. And it says you see 39 to one for each. Please continue.
All we like sheep have gone astray.
All of us, including me. We have become like sheep. We have gone astray.
We have turned everyone to his own way.
Hallelujah.
And the Lord has laid on him the iniquities of us.
The Lord has laid upon who? Jesus. The iniquities of us all. That is why we say today is a Good Friday. So out of the grave that we are supposed to have gone, he came and said, no. The Lord has laid everything upon him that you and I will have another life. That you and I are not going to bed tonight and going to weep over how I'm going to make it the next Monday. No. Everything has been laid upon him because he picked you from the grave and then he gave you another life. Please continue.
He was oppressed. And he was afflicted.
He was oppressed and afflicted. Most of us, when our relationship begin to get somehow this way, we begin to cry and we begin to say things. Stop. The moment it comes like that, picture one thing, Good Friday. For every year you celebrate it, but every year you cry. Every year you have sleeplessness and oppressions and depression. I never knew oppression is the nephew of oppression. And suppression, I don't know. If they come from the same family, they're all pressing. And then they will give you depression. Please continue.
He was oppressed and he was afflicted.
He was afflicted.
Yet he opened not his mouth.
He didn't complain. He was still because he knew the plan that he was carrying out. That you and I one day will come out of the grave and will give us another life. Please continue.
He was led as a lamb to the slaughter and as a sheep before its shearers in silence. So he opened not his mouth.
He couldn't speak a word.
Verse 8. He was taken from prison and from judgment. and who will declare his generation? Mm. For he was cut off from the land of the living.
Ah.
For the transgressions of my people, he was stricken.
That thing that at least you can take your seat. What Adam did there that caused him to die? When you read Genesis chapter 5, the Bible says, this is a genealogy of Adam. The day that the heaven and earth were created, when you read verse 5, the Bible says, and Adam grew 930 years, and then, please read it. Genesis chapter 5. Mm. Hallelujah. We serve an awesome God. God will never ever leave you alone without any plan for you. God always has plan. He is never short of plan. The moment you feel that things are not going well, he has a plan. Genesis chapter 5, what did he say?
Genesis chapter 5,
uh-huh.
From verse 1.
Verse 1.
This is the book of the genealogy of Adam.
Uh-huh.
In the day that God created man, he made him like him in the likeness of God.
Uh-huh.
He created the man and female, and blessed them and called them mankind in the day they were created.
Mm.
Verse 3.
Mm-hmm.
And Adam lived 130 years,
mm-hmm.
and he begot a son in his own likeness.
In his own likeness. So how Adam was, that's how he made his first son. So if Adam was like this, that was how the son was. Amen. But don't forget Genesis chapter 3. God said, the moment you touch this fruit, say, boom, that day you dead. And he did it. And that day he died. So God's spirit, like I said earlier, left him. And the verse 5 says, chapter 5 says, he produced after his own kind. Please continue.
And because the son in his own likeness, after his image, and named him Seth.
Uh-huh.
Verse 4. After he begot Seth, the days of Adam were 800 years, and he had sons and daughters.
You see the amazing thing? Please sit down. He has sons and daughters. So, if, I don't know the number of children that he had, but assuming he has 4 sons and maybe 5 daughters, each one of them will have 4, 4, 4. Multiplication is taking place. How many dead people do we have? How many? So God looked at it, and then he made a plan and said, no, a time will come that I have to send somebody. But you see, any time that God wants to do something on this earth, he doesn't send angels to come and do it. He used man. For example, when he needed to raise up a nation called Israel, he called a man called Abraham. When these people were in captivity in Egypt, they were hungry. He raised one man called Joseph who fed them. When the time came for him to bring them out of Egypt into the promised land, he raised one man called Moses. When they were coming through the wilderness, they were supposed to cross over to Jericho. He raised one man called Joshua. Joshua fought the battle and they entered to the promised land. Hallelujah. So anytime God wants to do something on earth, he doesn't use angels, he uses man. Amen.
Amen.
But here is a situation whereby God said, I need someone to save these people from there. The God said, hey, you don't need nobody else but a man. But whose blood is so pure enough to please all these Adam dead children? But let me ask you a question. What did God give to Adam that killed him?
Freedom?
No. God gave him something. That he abused it and he killed him.
A choice.
Precisely. Come again. He gave him his word. Say, Adam, the day you touch this fruit, it's a word he's given him. Right? Good. So the same word he gave him that killed him. God said, I'll use the same word. Hallelujah. God is wise. Look at the woman, Eve. Satan said, so did God really say that we shouldn't eat this fruit? You know, women, they talk. God said we should not eat it, not even touch it, we will not even go near to it. What was not there, she even added it. End of the day, fear, they fell. So God came to say, the same woman that you used to bring the downfall is the same woman I'm going to use to give me, God, a body to come on earth. And when I come, I'm going to crush your head. So whenever things are going wrong in your life, that time, give thanks. God is going to use that same thing to raise you up from the grave and give you another life.
Amen.
When I was in prison, I said, God, I thank you I'm here. After spending 1 year and 6 months, my case was not being dealt with. I begin to read the Bible. I say, hey God, if you have found a refuge, use this prison time to polish me. That was my prayer. And God did it. And today I'm polished. I'm not man of polishing. The same thing. So the same word that God used, that Adam abused it to kill him. God said, I'm not going to use God, no human being is pure enough for me to use. Therefore, that same thing. So God used his word. So John chapter 1, verse 1, the Bible says, in the beginning was the word. And the word was with God. And the word was what? God. So God used the same word to come on earth. That was Jesus Christ, who today we are celebrating. But Isaiah said, he was so much stricken that we could not even look at him. When you read verse 9, he said, he was taken from prison and from death to judgment. Who shall declare his generation? He's one man. He killed him off. Imagine your mother gave birth to you alone, a son. And then something happened, you are dead. Your generation has been cut off. Amen. Amen. My mother always said, you know you are my pension. Please, stay quiet, Leo. Don't do anything not to bring you a problem, because the moment you have a problem, it affects me. Of course, she was right, and she is right. But Jesus owned, he was only one son of God. Who can find Jesus' children? But today he has many brothers. You and I, we are many. Amen. Amen. So when you get to verse 10 of Isaiah chapter 15, the Bible says, yet it pleased the Lord, it pleased who? God, to bruise him. Because God couldn't find anybody perfect. Like the examples I just gave. When he needed a man to raise up a nation, Abraham was there. He needed a man to feed them, Joseph was there. He needed a man to lead them from captivity to the promised land, Moses was there. Every time, man. Like last time I said, without God, man cannot. And without man, God will not. So when the redemption plan was over, God said, who man should I use? Who should I send? The same word that Adam abused and he was killed. That same word, John 1:1, in the beginning was the word. That very beginning was the word. And the word was issued forth unto us. And when the word, the Bible says, he became flesh and lived among us, he had to do everything in accordance with the prophecy, what Isaiah said. So the Bible says in verse 10 that, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He had put unto him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin. So Jesus Christ made, God made Jesus as an offering for our sin. The sin that Adam committed. Through death he died. The threefold death. Jesus Christ was given to us. That is why this Easter is all about. That's why all this new Good Friday is all about. So in case you get out there and somebody say, you guys, you are saying that Good Friday, what is good about it? I have a story to tell. That my grandfather committed something that he was supposed to be killed. But God loved me so much. That time I was in the world. But God loved me so much that he gave his only begotten son. That if I believe, he didn't say if you pay your tithe. He didn't say if you offer too much offering in the church. No. It takes only one thing, to believe in him. Believing in him means that everything that he says, you believe and you accept and obey. That's all. So John chapter 1 verse 12 says, to them that believe in him, he gave them power. Say, power.
Power.
To become what? The children of God, or the sons of God. Adam was God's son, but now because of disobedience, he's gone. The last Adam had come. That if you believe in him, he give you the power, not just becoming, but the power. So sometimes if I see a Christian lady crying, I've been waiting for God for too long time, I'm waiting for my life, but there is no coming, and she's crying. Hey, sister. Don't forget, you are God's daughter. Mm. Why are you crying? Don't let me say this thing. I won't say it, otherwise you laugh. Amen. We should not cry. Anytime things go on worse in life, think about Good Friday. Why was it good? Because Jesus Christ came and conquered and defeated sin for us. Jesus conquered and defeated sin for us by death and burial and his resurrection. Like I said, God is a faith that man stand on. He says died, he was buried and resurrected. Even if you miss one, don't miss the rest. Let's see how Jesus died on the cross. like I said in the beginning, death also has three dimensions. When he was on the cross, he talked through his death. He said, Father, Father, why have you forsaken me? When God drove Adam from the garden, God said, go. He sent him away. There was a separation. So because of the sin upon him, God made this man so severe that God couldn't look at him. So God said, no, I can't work. You are not going to be looking. No. So he says, God, and said, Father, why have you forsaken me? And the account of Luke said, he gave up the ghost. He gave up the Holy Ghost. So if the Holy Ghost departs from you, you get a second death. And the last death, he said, the third one was, he bowed down and he breathed his last, and the spirit left him. So the day that Adam died in Eden, beginning, he says did the same thing to pay the price that you and I are supposed to have gone through. So you should be happy for today. So when we come to church, people are not dancing. Just look at them. You people don't know what you are missing. Glorify, if it's come, just roll the carpet. Because you can't pay a fraction of what he did for you. No. But when you sleep at night, and begin to make this beautiful noise. You don't know what is happening outside there. You don't know. But the next morning, thank God I am happy. You think it's your strength? Chocolate the day that you are dead. You are walking there. A man in three suits, peace, Versace, walking majestically. You're walking dead. Woman, this. With that Holy Spirit, a walking dead. Yet you don't give thanks to God. What is wrong with you? You see what I'm trying to say? Men don't have reason to praise God. So that when I come to church, I dance and I go home, I feel like, well, I say, God, are you happy for how I dance for you? And my spirit is deep. It's such as I put music around 4:30, dance in my house, in the morning, just dancing, and I'm happy because I can't pay for this price.
Amen.
Look at David. David sinned. The background story I just told you. He went and encountered the people. God said, hey, have I asked you? Choose three. Three dimension God. God gave him three choices. And 70,000 people were killed on his arrow. On his arrow. And you, this time is your own arrow. But somebody is paying the price. And you don't have a reason to thank God. So Jesus came to pick us out of this grave that we are supposed to go and give us another life. So this thing, never forget it. Out of the grave, he gave you another life. So be appreciative to this life that he has given you. Because somebody wanna be like you. Really, somebody wanna be like you. I was at the supermarket 3 days ago and my back was facing the entrance. A young man said, sir, please, can you take this? I think that was this man. Oh, and is that he was looking at me like this. Say, yo, guys, me, can I help you? And I always go to my work with my tie on and everything on. Please, can I help you? Hey, please, can you take? Say, wow, he's calling me, say. Back in those days, some years earlier, I had an African shop. This man was a graduate in Tilbox University, a doctor. The moment this man stepped in my shop, he began to give me the price he wants for the product I have there. Yeah, after all, what qualification do you need to sell these things? My brother, Ghana, they sell this one like 1 euro. You carry them, you commode them from Ghana, come here, sell. So it's not your fault. It's economy. The time will come. Now you see me, man, you're calling me, sir. God has turned the table around.
Amen.
So you see, if we see where God has picked you and brought you a different level, please, let's stand up and thank God. Let's stand up and thank God. His mercy is too much. You can't even count them. If I were you, every single day, my thanksgiving will exceed anything that I ask. Hello, Lord, somebody wanna be in my position. Somebody wanna be like me because you died for me. People out there, they envy me because I have eternal life in you. People out there, when they die, they don't know where they are going, but as for me, I have a faith in you that after my death, after the departure of my spirit from my body, I'm coming to you, Lord, you are about. This alone must give you a reason to thank God. Brother, sister, open your mouth and thank God for tonight. Thank him. Hallelujah. Lord, I thank you tonight. I thank you and I praise you because you have faithful and wonderfully made me. I thank you for this Good Friday, Lord. I thank you.
on the cross because you've taken my place. You died in my place. You died in my place. They chastised you because of me. You were shaking because of me. They spat upon you because of me. They beat you because of me. They judged you because of me. They put a crown of thorns on your head because of me. All because I was a walking dead man. All because I was a walking dead man.
Thank you.
And in your heart, Christ did.
Hold on, Paul.
Father, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Father, I bless you tonight. I thank you, Lord. I bless you, Lord, that you have taken my place. Father, I thank you. Who am I to stand your chastisement? Who am I to stand your condemnation? Who am I, Lord? Who am I? Father, tonight we thank you
for what you
praise you. We thank you
for what
you adore your name. We praise you for all that you have done, Lord.
Today I magnify you.
Lay under my sacrifice.
The Lord has done in the name of Jesus.